I may add on that, right? Because of at the end of the day, I think to make it simple, it goes back. I mean, as you know, gig economy is based on you complete a task, you get paid, right? So as a company, I think it boils down to a few points. Speed of getting talent. You don't need much round of interviews, right? 4 or 5 rounds, and then after 6 months, not knowing whether that person is the right one because you have to go through probation period, and within that probation period, you have to pay for medical benefits, you have to pay for other future life savings, etc. So the cost is much higher as compared to someone. Okay, I need someone to develop a website. Then you just get someone from the gig economy world. I pay you ringgit or $10,000. You build this, and we're done. That's it, right? Not need much of a round of interviews. Why? Because you can see their reviews, you can see their ratings before you about to hire them. This will actually increase the speed of getting talent. And not only that, like I mentioned just now, because of you don't have to pay for the medical benefits, etc. Because why? Whatever that the platform is asking you to pay, that is what you only need to pay. Okay, they are not if they ask you to pay for their life saving whatsoever, that is something that you have to that you have to deal with. But then if they don't ask you to pay, then you just pay for their fee, fee per hour, per project whatsoever. And this definitely reduce the operational costs. Because of after the pandemic or during the pandemic, many companies are trying to downsize because of the digitalization of everything. Previously, you need 10 persons to do 10 jobs, but now you can only have 1% to do 10 jobs or 10 tasks, right? It's different when we have, computer, internet and all. And the next thing is, I think this is the most crucial part because of, let's say your company is based in Singapore, Malaysia, or wherever you are, in your domain. When you have talents outside of your domain, outside of your country, it allows you have to have a cross-border collaboration, from one country to another. That will increase the creativity, right? Because of sometimes, you might need someone to think out of the box. So that might not share the same culture as you, might really be critical of what you always do, So this definitely will increase the creativity, and I think it will allow the team to, for example, for project-based basis that you need a group of people from wherever they are with different expertise. I think it can speed up the process to do things, and you can do wonders with it. So there are many benefits when we talk about leveraging on the gig economy. So I hope that answers Peter's question.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Akif and Kay. Is there any other questions? Farah actually is a certified coach and also trainer. I believe that especially during the pandemic, so most of the sessions are being done or conducted via online. So this is, I think, a simple example of a gig economy, but it's beyond that actually. Yeah, as I mentioned by Akif just now, last time when you want to hire someone from overseas, so you have to manage a lot of immigration issues, visa, and then a lot of papers that we have to settle. But now we can hire anyone all over the world, and what we need to do actually is just to manage the process and also the result. We need not to manage the all the visa on the immigration, but somehow there are difficulties as well, as mentioned by Kay and also Akif just now, because now how to manage the situation of even though there's a lot of scam out there. So but how to identify and manage, because this is and I agree this is a part of the knowledge that maybe it's not to maybe, but I think it's very new to HR, but somehow or other we need to prepare ourselves. We need to be in advance as compared to the rest. I think in Malaysia, I can share maybe some of the companies, they are also not so much of a gig economy right now, but maybe on an agency management, so they appoint like part-timers and some of the employees, not as employee but as agent, so they can get better result, more result. So and as HR, we have to be more knowledgeable in this area, so how we can advise the business to leverage on the gig economy and gig worker, and to get more profitable, to be more profitable. Now, it's not so much about how many percent you hire, but at the end of the day, you know, how to transform from HR from being managing permanent or fixed term contract employees, you know, to I would say a fixed term contract as well for the gig economy, but it's an unlimited talent that we have all over the way. So any further questions from the participant?
Zoo, can I share something?
Yeah, please.
I think for this gig economy, right, earlier we talked about talent acquisition. I think it really helps organizations resolve the issue of the talent acquisition. But apart from that, I think it can do more with this gig economy. Because I understand that some organizations have started creating their own small gig economy in the organization, within the organization. How they do that is that wherever they have any, they need any skills, and then they will advertise within the organization. Say, for example, now they need somebody who has these photography skills. Then they advertise within the organization to see if any employees have this kind of talent. Then by doing so, the employer will be given a small, maybe the amount of compensation. And also by doing so, they're able to discover talents of the organization and also help in their staff engagement. So you can see that gig economy actually done more than just a talent acquisition. It also help staff engagement and also deliver discovering more talent within our organization. So it really helps a lot from the organization perspective. That's all I would like to share from the organization perspective. So HR has more to do, right? I also have
Thanks, Ethan. Yeah, Peter also mentioned about outsourcing. Yes, this is part of outsourcing, but last time we used to talk about outsourcing, physical outsourcing, but now it's a virtual outsourcing. So this is something, as I mentioned, it's something new, and there's a lot of legality behind it. There's a lot of technical behind it that we have as HR, we have to know. In fact, I think with the gig economy, with the gig worker, with the gig era, I believe that, I think everyone heard that we are facing with the great resignation, right? I mean, my organization also, I think it's not excuse to this phenomena of a great resignation. So with the gig economy, we can manage as HR, as a business, we can manage a lot better. In fact, this is the introduction course. I believe it's an introduction course, which I think is would be helpful for the HR for you later to be prepared as a future HR. At the same time, we will be going to also introduce later and a certified program for HR for the gig era as well, right? Later. But that will be sharing later. So any further question from the participant, Jamila? Jamila also is now is a trainer and consultant. I believe that most of the programs that we conducted during the pandemic basically is online, right?
Yeah, feel free to ask.
Yeah, feel free to ask, because we are approaching to talk 2:48 in Malaysia time. So if you have any further questions, so please do ask.
Yeah. If I may share, I mean, like something. You know, I mean, like since the past few years, we actually have had hired many gig workers along the way. You know, for to achieve our business, you know, goals and all. So there are gig workers that we are so comfortable with that we keep regularly hire the same person over and over again over the past few years. You know, like because of they have done a good work. They don't talk much. They this is what we want. This is what you do. Get it done, and we pay you. That's it. So we've been hiring the same person over and over, instead of hiring you know a full-time employee, which actually costs more than that because of there are many things that we have to consider. You know, when it comes to the benefits, and knowing that the millennials now they actually prefer to have more, not just money, but you know the additional perks. Like if I work with you, what else can I get? So to retain them can be really hard. Instead of the way we retain the gig workers, you know, and there are gig workers that we had issues with, you know, that did not do a good job. So that's it. Once that person, you know, did that to us, okay, that's it. This is the last time we are going to work with you. Done. So our cost stops there. No more processes. You know, like exiting. You know, when you want to exit the company or to fire someone or whatsoever. Yeah, there are many processes after that, right? In the corporate. So that's it with the gig workers. So at the end of the day, what I'm trying to say is that the past few years was very impactful for us in terms of managing our costs because of we only pay them when they are productive. That's it, not when they are idle. Okay. If they are not being productive enough, meaning your the task that you're giving to them is just not clear enough. Or maybe you have to be really specific. This is what I want. This is what you need to do. And this is the deadline. Get it done. Right. So if they do a good job, yep, you can continue hire them. If they don't, then you can stop. So there are many things, I think, in terms of the processes that you can take advantage of, you know, time, that's it, and cost.
Yeah, I think actually, also we have that experience, right, Rita? So we have a developer, a web developer, we have a visual assistant, which, wherever we find that, you know, cannot meet our demand or our request, or cannot do the task as per our requirement, and that's it. And I think, Akif and also, Kay, they are talking based on experience. Yeah? So, they also have to gig projects that, you know, they hire virtual workers, not only from Malaysia, but also from other countries. So this is the way that they will share with us on how to manage the situation, especially those, you know, when the person that they hire not delivering based on their requirements, yeah? And what are the legality involved and things like that. So I think as an HR, we need to not only understand about law, HR employment law in the country, but what about the other countries when you hire gig worker? So I believe if there's no more question, any last word?
Zul, yeah, just very quick one to Akif. Yeah, Akif, when you hire a person, is the rate, the fees different from one person to another, or you have a very generic standard fee? Yeah, paid to them based on their task given.
Okay, it's a good question. Okay, so the way at the end of the day, how you want to get the gig workers, it will be up to the gig platform itself, the gig economy platform, okay. Right? What kind of mechanism that they are introducing? Usually in the marketplace, let's say Fiverr, Fiverr or freelancer, you know, there are many ways for you to post your job. Either you want to do it as like a competition whereby the freelancer will bid for it. You know, show them. They will show you your design first or whatsoever, and then you will choose who are the winner. Then you can hire.
Oh.
Okay, and then another one is like just like RFP. You know, you post a job, and then somehow the freelancers or the gig workers will start to do the bidding,
okay, and then
you,
okay.
what which one of them can offer the best value, and also maybe value in term of monetary is not really a thing for you, but you want more of quality. So you can check their portfolios, you know, and then maybe some like us, we are like in the between, you know, trying to balance the cost and also the quality. So we're trying, we'll try to find the, you know, the one that will be, you know, not the lowest, but slightly low as compared to the other bidders. So the price is actually, it can be up to you whether you want to tell them first your price, how much that you're willing to pay them, or you want them to bid for your project.
Yep.
Yeah. So usually, like for example, in our case, we wanted to hire a mobile app developer. Okay, because why? Because we don't have the capability to do so. So we need another person to do our mobile app. So how to do that? We try to find someone in Malaysia, and then again, that person charged us for like you know, more than 10,000 ringgit, right? And the quality was very terrible, and we only get to know that quality after 5 months of hiring that person. So that was like it hurt us a lot because of how I wish we knew his portfolio before and maybe some of his previous clients, you know, because of we met him face to face in Malaysia, so we did not know much of this guy's capabilities based only on his word of mouth or whatever that in the proposal that he showed to us, but nothing much from the past clients, right? So then we changed our strategy. Okay, you know what? Now let's go to the gig economy platform. Let's try to hire someone from there. Mm. And we post our job, and turns out many people actually bid for our project, and because we sent RFP. So when we check all of the proposal that was sent to us, then we you know, narrow down to a few, and then we check their reviews, their ratings, which was easy because of everything was online, right? Mm. So we don't want to repeat the same mistake, and ended up we managed to find someone from Pakistan that offer much lower as compared to the Malaysian guy, and they managed to complete the project within 12 days rather than 5 months. Why? Because we know the ratings, we know the portfolio, rather than, you know, just word of mouth or whatever that he says or she says. So that's the beauty of trying to hire someone online, because everything is transparent there. And even after we pay them, there is no such thing as, hey, can you pay us more? You know, because of they just want tips or whatsoever, like just pay us more. But it depends on you. But then through the gig economy platforms, you know, once they agree to a specific price, we pay that and that's it. So I think it saves us a lot of time. 12 days.
Yeah, at the same time, I think.
Yeah.
As a lot of marketplace as compared to social media, like LinkedIn and also other marketplaces that's available, I think like Huber, there's a rating, and also there's also feedback from other customers which you can refer to.
Referral.
So, So that would reduce the error of hiring. You know, that will be and also financial loss, as mentioned by Keith.
Yeah, costly.
So I mean, like at the end of the day, what we want you guys to have is like, once you attend the program, you'll be able to understand, you know, comprehensively how the economy works. You know, because if you want to change something in your organization, because there are many things that you have to change, the processes, the procedures, and all, which department has to leverage on the gig economy. Not all department can leverage on the gig economy, right? Mm-hmm. But marketing, the IT and all that, there are certain departments that you can leverage. But if you don't know how the gig economy works in totality, how do you want to advise them? How do you want to bring it to the management? How do you want to change the organization, right? To reduce the cost and all. So at least you have the fundamental basics or knowledge on how the gig economy works. Then only you can suggest something that will be more fruitful. Yeah.
In fact, I will tell you that some of the HR job right now is being done by the business. For instance, you know, Peter talked about outsourcing. Outsourcing for some companies, they're not being managed by HR, because you know, if you're in marketing, you want to hire outsourcing PR, so PR department will do. So So that will reduce the, you know, the reliance or responsibility of HR. But more and more, if you're focusing more in that area on outsourcing, and there will be less and less job for HR. So now we have, that's what I said, I mean, for the gig work, gig economy and gig era, there's a I would say that there will be a revision of the everything. Maybe if we can HR practitioner can master in this area, so I believe that, you know, the business will come back to HR for the advice as, with regards to the hiring of a gig worker. So with that, Rita, I would like to final word from you. Rita is president and also founder of HRM.
Thank you, Zhu. Actually, I would like to end the session with one question and one piece of information. For the question, recently I've surfed the net about the highest income of a gig worker in the world. Would you like to give a guess? What is the yearly income of the gig worker in the world? The highest one, the highest income. Although we know that company hire gig workers for cost savings or for some scarcity in the skills, but we also have some interesting information about the highest income earner as a skill, as a gig worker in the world. We like to give a guess.
1 million, 2 million? 2 million?
2 million. US or what? Okay, the right answer is $500,000. I think it's not bad in a year. Yeah, so I think it's quite an attraction as a worker. So if you really want to know more, so join us again next week, next Saturday, the same time, to know more about this gig worker before you participate in our certification program. So we have the same teaser schedule for next Saturday at 2:00, the same time. Okay, so anything from our today? Anything we want to add before we end the session? Aki?
All good from my side.
Okay. So if no, then that's all for the session today. And we'll see you next Saturday, the same time. So there'll be no more. Right. Anybody want to be to challenge the highest income earner as a gig worker? Attend our session.
Yeah, I would like to do that, definitely.
Yeah. Jamila also can do that.
Yeah. Now, okay. Rather than, you know, wait for the 10,000 that's being to
different exactly.
From our ETF, Improved for Brain Fund.
Exactly.
Then, you know, we can do this and get 1 million. So this is a
age is not a problem. For people like me, age is not a problem. The desire, the perseverance is very important.
Yeah, but of course, there's a two side of the session. That one is from HR perspective, or if you want to hire a gig worker, and another one actually is as a gig worker, what you need to prepare yourself.
Yep.
I think it's a good, very good, because I definitely believe so that, you know. Maybe last time we thought that, you know, gig worker will be here, will dominate the market maybe in next 10 or 15 years from now. But I don't think so. It will take that long.
Yep.
I think that it will, you know, it will take at most will be 5 years, or even 3 years, then the gig worker will control the economy. I think if you read a lot of some of the information on gig worker, I think the whole transaction or economy about a gig worker, I think it's more than for the whole world, I think it's more than 20 billion now. So it's one of the fastest growing business in the world. So now people are no longer working looking for a permanent job. Now a lot of people are looking for. Well, in fact, I heard in Malaysia, Rita, 1% is just becoming a virtual assistant, and her earning for 2 years, cumulatively is about 2 million. So you can find that in YouTube. So it's very encouraging.
Yeah.
And also very,
that's very encouraging. Yeah.
In fact, she managed to do that from Own home.
Yeah. From home.
Without, yeah, without having to go through all the traffic jam. Mm-hmm.
I think now is also the time to really explore this, because of we talked to our mentor as well, Datuk Nora Abdul Manaf of Maybank. Mm. Yeah, I mean, like, she's the one who launched our app anyway. So, she's trying so hard to leverage on the gig economy with Maybank, one of the biggest bank in Malaysia, the largest actually. Yeah, and also that day we had a meeting with Petronas. Petronas also, trying to tap into our expertise to how to leverage on the gig economy, because they are also trying to leverage on trying to hire gig workers. I think up to they're trying to test up to 50 persons, 50 to 100 from my second. So and then the, also like another fund manager, asset management, like for example Tabung Haji, they're also trying to leverage on the gig economy. So I think in Malaysia, the corporates are really looking into this. You know, maybe they are trying to do it on a staggered basis, maybe like by a group of people first, then only they will try do it comprehensively. And the thing is like about Maybank also, because of that, I think similarly with what Cik Zul just now shared, they're also trying to tap on their internal employees to do the jobs. Was it Rita or Cik Zul? Yeah.
Internal.
So, they're actually creating the platform for that, you know, to make it easy. I think this is how technology can change things, right? And if not now, then when?
Yeah. Yeah, some company is doing that already.
Yeah,
company doing that. Zul.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, they're doing that.
Mm-mm. Yeah, I think Jamila and team also has made a good money during the pandemic with virtual consultation. I believe so.
Yeah. Alhamdulillah.
Okay, I think it's already 5 minutes past 3. So yep. So we'll be seeing you guys again, and please do share with your, as you said, the members, friends, family, who wants to join with the HR or non-HR or the future HR or future gig worker, they can join. Please join, do join us in our next session. So with that, thank you very much, and see you again.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.